South by Style presents Digital Marketing in the Age of Influencers with Amber Venz Box.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Amber Venz Box, and I'm the co-founder of Reward Style and Like to Know It. I want to start by just thanking South by for inviting me to speak here this year. I've been coming for many, many years, and I think that this is, it's really exciting for us to be acknowledged and recognized for our work in this space. And I think it'd be, you know, any founder's bucket list item to be here today. So thank you so much for that. We're going to start by just talking about a little bit about me, and then Reward Style, just so you guys can get the background of you know, my experience in this industry. Then we'll move into some technical, sociological, economic kind of factors that have been made a big impact on the industry. And then we'll close up with just some things that I think you all can apply to your businesses. After about 45 minutes, we're going to move into questions. So do save those, and we'll call you to the aisle in the middle when we're finished and have a discussion. So when I was a little kid, even as early as like second grade, I remember watching Mary-Kate and Ashley Olsen adventure movies. And I love these movies because they were in Paris and they were in New York and they were at slumber parties and they had these great outfits. And it was really all about the outfits. So I'd watch these shows, I'd see what they were wearing, and then I'd go back to my closet and see how I could match it up and how I could wear exactly what Mary-Kate and Ashley wore. So, you know, I always loved fashion. And by the time I got to fifth grade, I wanted to kind of participate in the industry a little more. And I guess you could say that my entrepreneurial drive was identified pretty early. In about fifth grade, I was, my grandmother had taught me how to knit scarves. And so I was knitting scarves and then selling them on the back row of math class and was asked to leave. And by high school, I took it a little bit further. I actually launched a jewelry line, and so this is me here just shooting one of the lookbooks for my jewelry line. And then, you know, after high school, I decided that I was going to go to college, and I went to SMU in Dallas. And after my freshman year at SMU, I started working at a local retail shop. And this was my dream job through and through. I actually, when I went in for the interview for this job, I said, it's my dream to work at a store like this, and I just want to be around people like you. Do you have a friend who has a store kind of like this that I could work for? Because I think I was maybe too timid to ask directly, can I just work here for you? I got the job, and I absolutely loved it. I got to do everything with these owners. It was a husband and wife team, and they let me do everything from buying to merchandising the store. I worked there 40 hours a week, all while being a full-time student at SMU. The owners also picked up my jewelry line, and so I was able to gain experience working for somebody else, all while building my own brand. And then in 2008, at the age of 20, I met my now husband and business partner, Baxter Box. When I met Baxter, I was really deep into the jewelry business, and so I loaded up all of my jewelry that I'd created, and I brought it in a rolling suitcase over to his house, and I laid it all out, and I was telling him where I'd found all the pieces and the inspiration for everything that I had made. And of course, he was completely uninterested in everything I had to say. But I think what sparked his interest is when I pulled out my spreadsheet, which is where I actually tracked my business, and he was able to see the sales that I was just you know, pulling through this one store. That sparked his interest, and we actually ended up forming a business partnership, and Baxter helped me to grow my business, launch e-commerce, and then eventually quit my full-time job to do jewelry full-time. So after leaving my full-time job, I really missed styling, because in that job, I mentioned I got to go buy the clothes, I got to merchandise the store, I had my specific clients that I bought for all the time, and so when we go to New York to the showrooms, you know, I'd buy 2 size 8 of that Chloe wedge because I knew that so-and-so liked it and she'd want one for her house and one for her boat, and I was very intimately involved with our customers and what they would be wearing. And so I launched a personal shopping business, and what that meant was that I would take customers, women or men, into local boutiques, and I would dress them either for an event or for a season or for a vacation. And the way that I was compensated was that the store owners would pay me a commission on whatever my customers ended up purchasing. So this is something that they were already doing. If you go into, you know, your local department store here, you know, there's Neiman Marcus down the road, but whatever your, you know, mid to high-end luxury kind of boutiques and department stores are in your town, this is the way it works for store clerks. They're paid on a commission. And you know, I really love the personal styling element, and I was hoping to actually be able to get more offline customers. So then I launched a blog. I launched VenzEdits.com, and this was 6 years ago. So this might look like what you're typically seeing today from bloggers, but this was big time for me then. I had had somebody come and design my site. I had created this logo. I was documenting everything I did, you know, across the jewelry line and my personal shopping, and I'd hired a photographer. I was all in on this blog and totally fell in love with it. And you know, I mentioned this was 6 years ago. This is a clip from the Dallas Morning News. They did a full page article on Meet the Blogger. And the reason I think this is such a cool and hilarious article now looking back is there would never be an article on somebody launching a blog today because it's that ubiquitous. At the time, it was this incredible novel idea and it required, you know, a story in the paper. So as I continued on with my blogging, I realized that I had actually cut myself out of my own business. One day, one of my key clients called me and said, "Hey, Amber, you posted about that Proenza Schooler PS1 bag," which was the hot designer bag at the time. And she said, "And I bought it, and I was the first one of all my friends to have it. Thank you so, so much for posting. Keep posting more stuff." And that was just knife through the heart, because at the time, you know, I'm living at home. There was no paycheck to paycheck, so that would be generous to say I was living paycheck to paycheck. That $150 that I would have gotten commission on selling that bag, that was meal money for several weeks. And so that was kind of a painful moment and also a turning point for me of how do I, you know, I've just cut myself out of my offline business. My customers are now going online. So how do I make this my business, my blog my business? So I decided to go to New York. There weren't really many bloggers around Dallas, where I lived then and live now. And so I went to a blogger meetup, and my goal was I'm gonna figure out how these girls are making money or what they're doing in their community to make this a go. And I met a blogger that you guys all probably know if you're familiar with the style industry. She's still one of the biggest out there. And I asked her, "How are you making money on your blog?" And she said, "Well, I get free clothes and I get invited to events." And I was like, right, so neither one of us are making any money on our blogs. You know, at the time, blogging was something that was a creative outlet and it was a passion project, but I really couldn't afford for it to be a passion project. This wasn't something that was, I mean, it was fun for me, but it wasn't just fun for me. It had a purpose. The reason that I had really launched the blog in the first place was to be a marketing tool for my jewelry business and to be something that was gonna drive more offline customers for me and my personal shopping business. So this wasn't a fun hobby. So back to Baxter. So Baxter and I, you know, love building and growing businesses together, and that's something that we've done together over the past, I guess, almost 8 years now. When I came home from New York, he said, "So what'd you find out?" And I was like, "That everyone else is broke or living off their daddy too." And so I heard a clap, I think. That's good. So he just said, "Okay, well, let's figure this out. So, you know, how do you want to make money on your blog? Like, ideal world, unicorns, everything is on limits. How do you do this?" And my only experience in really what I was doing was this personal shopping. And so if I took a client again into a store, I'd get a commission on sales. So I said, well, that's what I want to do, because, you know, that client that bought the PS1 bag that I would have made that $150 commission on, except that I can't go knock on Net-a-Porter's door and say, "You owe me $150. I need to be able to do that online. And so he said, "Okay, well, what is this business gonna be called?" And I was 22 years old at the time, and I said, "Well, Reward Style, because if you have great taste and people love your recommendations and you're great at styling clothing, then you'll make money." And so we started kind of just researching the market. Baxter had had other businesses before. Clearly, I had had other businesses before. And we looked at, you know, market size, what's happening in retail, and then what's happening in the blogging space. And both, you know, when we looked at both, it was clear that this was a huge opportunity if we were able to get this right. There are a lot of people who are gonna need to turn this hobby into a career, or who would want to turn this hobby into a career. So we went to our friends. We met up at a local Irish pub, And we said, we've got this idea, it's called Reward Style. We're gonna help style bloggers make money on their content. This is how it's gonna work. And we'd like for you to, you know, pitch in and help us get this business off the ground. We need to pay a developer to start building this product. And one of our closest friends stopped and he said, Baxter, if this is such a big deal, why haven't you quit your job? And at that moment he said, I will quit my job. And he did. And he came to join us. And so this is a cool picture to us because this was, you know, Baxter gave me $800 to furnish our first office. So I took this canvas out of my own bedroom, had something on it that was kind of ugly, and bought some paint and started painting. And so this is actually still in our office today, but this was our logo there. Baxter and I are really very yin and yang. So I clearly, you know, had the fashion side of the business. His background is in engineering, technology, and investing. And so he has, you know, kind of that other side of the brain. So as co-founders, we work very well together because we work in very different sides of the business, and we very much so needed each other. You know, I don't have a problem admitting that I have trouble setting up a printer on my computer. Baxter was able to, you know, identify and distill down what it was that, you know, I needed in order to be successful on my blog and really make those dreams come true. So to get this started, we had to build out a network. And so network has two sides. You have publishers and you have retailers. So we started with the publishers. We started with the retailers. Went out and just started, you know, calling and said, hey, if we can get some publishers who create really beautiful content to write about your brands and about your products, would you be willing to pay a commission on their content? Really, the main point of friction was that no one worked with bloggers. And so we were passed around marketing departments, and you know, no one wanted to be in business, you know, with a blogger, and certainly influencer wasn't part of marketing vernacular. But on the other hand, this wasn't a monumental ask for them because this is something that they'd already been doing. You know, if you remember, we talked about how they're paying, you know, a commission to somebody. It's either a salesperson in the store or it's a salesperson online. So as long as they were willing to work with us and really just adapt their model into what consumers were actually doing today, which is, you know, less and less going into stores and more discovering product online, then we could work together. So our early day clients, our first two were Shopbop and Net-a-Porter. And for us, we had enough coverage there to start working on the publisher side. So going out to publishers, you'll remember none of us were getting paid. So this wasn't a hard ask either. I called that publisher that I mentioned earlier that was a big New York style blogger, and I said, hey, are you making any money yet? No. Well, if I can offer you a solution where you can make money on the content that you were already gonna create, we're just gonna track it for you and bill a commission, would you do that? And you know, the yes was so loud you could hear it in the other room even if you weren't on the phone. And so at that point, we launched Reward Style. So on the month of my 23rd birthday, we opened an office. And so these are some pictures from those of you who know Dallas. It was in Mockingbird Station in a residential loft, the smallest one that they have, and about three of us fit in it. But this was our launch party. You can see I'm the one in the middle. I was blonde and tan at that point. So, did it work? Well, you know, you look at today, and there are 9,000 publishers across 80 countries who use this product. There are 4,000 retailers and 500,000 brands. And I think you could say that consumers like us as well. 200 million consumers have made a purchase based on Reward Style influencer content. I want to share our mission with you guys because you'll see at the end how this is really important. Our mission is to empower the world's influential publishers to achieve maximum economic success by providing an ecosystem of innovative technology, strategic consulting, and global brand partnership opportunities. By doing those three things, over the last 4 years, we've been able to drive $500 million in retail sales to our partners. Sorry, that was just last year, about $500 million in retail sales. Overall, we've already driven, in the last 4 years, we've driven over $1 billion. An interesting stat that I came across just last week was that we account for 7% of the all web traffic to one of the largest multi-brand luxury retailers in the US. So we've been incredibly impactful on the retail industry. It's a pretty exciting time to be an influencer or a retailer or a consumer. So how did we see all that growth? What did we do? Well, there's a couple of different things. First of all, when we started Reward Style, I mentioned 22, 23-year-old girl, I just wanted to show people my outfits and how to put them together. And so we worked with all the fashion retailers. So it started with Shopbop and Net-a-Porter, and then I was finally able to afford an apartment. And so I wanted to talk about products from West Elm and Pottery Barn and Target. And then I started getting wrinkles. And so we needed Clinique and Prescriptives and MAC and Sephora. And then Baxter and I finally got married. And so I wanted to talk about stationery lines and wedding dresses. And you know, just 4 months ago, we had a child who's here. And little birdie wears cute outfits every day. And I wanted to be able to show, you know, all the products that I buy for her, whether it's her strollers or her bottles. And so as I needed more and more, you know, breadth of product, we actually recruited, you know, that breadth of retailers. And so we now don't just work in the fashion space, we're working across all of these different verticals. And as you can imagine, those opened up new doors for us with every type of retailer that we brought on. Something that else that happened during this time was just the growth of all of these different channels. So when we launched Reward Style, we were really just working with bloggers. It was nice if the blogger had a Facebook page or a Twitter page, but it wasn't really a must-have. We launched 2011. By 2012, we started seeing new social platforms that were interesting pop up. And so today, a given influencer is going to publish on a handful of platforms every single day. And so with each of those channels, that became a new opportunity for us and a new type of influencer, because the girl who's big on Pinterest might not have a big blog, or the girl who's done an incredible job on Instagram, may not be great on YouTube. And so there's, you know, not only are our publishers extending their businesses into all of these new channels, but we're able to actually attract a new type of influencer who is specific to these channels. So these are opportunities for us. What we've done is just really built products that track and monetize each of these channels. So no matter where our publishers want to create or distribute their content, they're able to do that with us and actually truly extend their business and monetize those channels. Another way that we expanded, I guess a third way, would be globally. And so we've talked about vertical expansion, channel expansion, and then we look to grow around the world. So in 2011, we opened our Dallas office. 2012, we opened London. Since then, over the last 4 years, we've grown from a concept into a pretty large company. We now have 180 team members across 5 offices. Those team members speak more than a dozen languages. And we've been able to help our publishers extend their businesses into new territories, and same with our retailers. And then we've been able to also extend our consumer reach by launching in all of these regions. I mentioned earlier we have publishers in 180 countries, and we've reached consumers. And when I say reach, I mean consumers in over 200 countries have actually made purchases based on the content of our consumers. So that's kind of what was happening on the Reward Style of the business, but there's some things happening culturally. First of all is just technology. So when we started Reward Style, I wasn't taking pictures on my cell phone. And when you look at just the hardware and software and what that has really enabled us to do, we all have Wi-Fi connected phones that are sitting in our hands right now with really high quality cameras. These cameras are with us 24 hours a day, and we have editing apps that make these images really, really beautiful. Beyond technology, oh, and here's some of my favorite editing apps, if you were curious. Beyond technology, the second thing that I think that's really contributed to the really extreme success of this industry is distribution. So, our generation, we're not more, any more talented in that we're not better stylists, we're not better photographers, we're not better writers necessarily than any other generation. It's just that we're more popular. And that's because we've been able to put our content and our product across all of these channels and able to, grow an audience. So without an Instagram, I wouldn't have 70,000 followers that I'm speaking to before I come on stage today. These are all because of these platforms, we have the opportunity to reach consumers around the world, which is what makes the global nature of our business important. So why is it that blogging isn't just the flavor of the month, and why is it that it's actually here to stay and has a permanent place in the fashion industry? It's because of monetization. So you have the technology, the hardware, the software, you have the distribution now, but without the monetization, it's not gonna go anywhere. And with plugging reward style into that, being an influencer is now a career option. We're now in the age of the influencer, so let's think about that. We're now, influencer is a career option. This is Chiara, one of our clients. She's one of the largest bloggers in the world, based in Italy and LA. These are her covers. This is incredible. When I say that influencer is a career option, I have an 8-year-old niece who told me the other day that she wants to be a YouTuber because she wants to review toys. And she knows which products are Target exclusives, but she can't even spell exclusive. And if she's good enough at it, then she can join Reward Style and make a career of it. So, we've talked about publishers and bloggers and publishing, and so I want to show you just kind of what that looks like and what's changed. In a great way, not a lot, but also in this subtle way, it's changed the industry. So this is a image of Blair from Atlantic Pacific. So Blair on the left-hand side of your screen, that's an image from her blog whenever we recruited her back in 2011. So when I first talked with Blair, I told her, it'd be interesting if you'd tell us what, brands you were wearing or show us what you have on, because her blog was much like a Tumblr in that she was creating these beautiful pictures and it was just image after image after image. It was this beautiful inspiration like you see in a lot of places. Blair's transformation after working with Reward Style was, I would compare it to, it's like when Pinterest or Tumblr turns into House. It's like you go to House because you want actionable information. You're getting service. You know you can actually buy what you land on. So the change with Blair was subtle, but this is what we do for publishers and retailers and consumers. And what you'll notice, the difference, is that she's actually now showing you exactly what she has on. So she's telling you, and she's also showing you visually, you can now get my outfit. Another cool thing about this is you can see how this has enabled her, or really empowered her, to professionalize. The picture on the left from a couple years ago is a much less professional experience than what you're experiencing on the right. So Blair's winning because she's able to actually make a career out of this. She's now quit her job. She was very high up at a major US designer, and she's now focusing on her blog and her publishing career full time. Blair has also extended her business. We talked about, all the channel expansion. And so she's not only publishing to her blog, she's now extended her business into Instagram. But the thing about publishing is it's very similar to retail in that part of it's about your product selection and what you're showing. The other part is about your service. Think about why you guys choose to use the retailers that you use. It's partially because they have the stuff you like, but then also partially because they treat you really well and they give you, the service that you need. And with Blair extending her, her business into Instagram, she needed to be able to tell her followers and customers what products she was wearing. And so what you'll notice in her captions is that she has a Like to Know It link in those captions. And what that does is it actually allows her followers to like her photos and get these Instagrams to her inbox with all the associated product information. So they can trigger that email if they're interested in what she's wearing and find out exactly what's happening. And so she has now successfully been able to extend her business there. And this is just kind of a look at those captions so you would know what that little link looks like. Like to Know It is actually a product that we built in order to help our publishers extend their business into this platform. And so what we saw was that around 2013, our publishers started creating more content on Instagram than any other platform. They were seeing more engagement there and more growth there. And so being platform agnostic, we needed to work within the boundaries that Instagram had set out from their user experience and create something that was gonna help our brands, our retailers, and our consumers to all be successful. And so this is our Like to Know It product. It is a consumer product. While Reward Style itself is B2B, this is B2C. You just go to liketoknow.it, you register your Instagram account and your email address. And you can choose if you want to get emails as soon as possible, daily, weekly. And then whenever you like photos that are like to know it enabled, it'll actually send an email to your inbox with that information. So here's a look at one of our publishers, Ami from Song of Style, and she is used like to know it. You like that photo, you'll see what the email looks like to your inbox. You can immediately click through to purchase what Ami wore. So these girls are offering that same level of service across different platforms. I want to show you a little bit about like to know it. You know, is it working? Well, I think our consumers would say it's working for them. We've influenced sales in 242 countries. We have 1.7 million followers on our own Instagram, which is where we promote those publishers that are using like to know it. There's over 1,000 pieces of unique like to know it content created every single day. So that's a publisher going in, uploading their photo, tagging those products so that their consumers could then get that information directly to their inbox. Last year, we drove over $77 million in retail sales. So just to put that in perspective, we launched 2014 mid-year. We drove about $10 million in retail sales that year, $77 million last year. So consumers understand it, they're using it, and they're buying based off of it. Right now, there's about 6 million emails that are triggered monthly. So that's when someone sees the Instagram, they like the Instagram to get that email to their inbox. And this is a cool stat. 95% of these users actually choose to get the information as soon as possible. So people who are coming to blogs, to Instagram, to YouTube, they have intent to purchase. And I think like to know it shows that very, very well, because of these people who are signing up, they don't want to wait till the end of the day. They don't want to wait till the end of the week. They want it immediately because they need that information because they do have that intent to purchase. So what's next? Well, if you're just looking at what's happening, you know, I think in retail in general, you'll see that retail sales are up about 4.3%. We went from 4.7 trillion in 2014 to 4.9 trillion last year. But what I'm really interested in is the growth of e-commerce. And so e-commerce was up 12%. And we went from 305 billion to 341 billion that year. So it's big, it's exciting, it's growing quickly. What's cool is this is inning number one. This is still early days. This is not even the beginning of a spectrum. And that's what I think what's cool about this industry and what's cool about what's happening in retail, in the content space, in the social sharing space. So I'm a fashion girl, you might be an investor dude. Why is this relevant to you? I hope that some of the things that I was able to share with you guys are applicable to your own businesses or your own dreams. And here's the key things that I want you to understand from today. Reward style solves a real problem. And this is why, you know, we have been successful and why I have every confidence that we will continue to be successful. We solve a problem, but most importantly, we continue to innovate. So you saw that whenever we launched Reward Style, Instagram wasn't even around. We reacted quickly to that. We found a solution that consumers responded to, and we helped our retailers and our publishers be successful in this new era of Instagram. So solve a real problem and continue to innovate, because what's a good idea today might not be a good idea tomorrow and might not sustain you. The second thing I wanted you to hear today was just focusing on the long game. So we, you know, establish our mission, we stick to our mission. We continue to invest in our team. As you saw, our team's now 180. We continue to invest regionally. We now have 5 offices around the world, speaking more than a dozen languages. We invest in our partnerships, in our consumers, in our retailers through education. You know, if you happen to follow my Instagram, you'll see we are around the world all the time, and it's not just me. Our team is on the ground with our clients all the time, investing in them. We're focused on the long game, and we only invest in things that align with our mission. Next is have a revenue strategy. This is sometimes a novel idea, I think, in this space. We, you know, had a revenue strategy from day one. We were making money from day one, which has allowed us to have so many opportunities and have just really larger control over our destiny. So if you can do this, this is the way forward. And next, hire people with complementary strengths. So I mentioned earlier, you know, Baxter and I are very much yin and yang. I know nothing about technology, he knows nothing about fashion, but I know what we need and he knows how to make it happen. So you know, whenever we think about hiring partnerships, we look for complementary skill sets. So whenever you're doing that, whether you're just launching your business or you're hiring or you're looking for people to partner with, find people that complement you. Next, it seems obvious, but really love what you do. I think it was hopefully clear to you guys that from a very, very early age, I was absolutely obsessed with all things fashion and wearing outfits and being a part of the industry and watching the industry. And you know, that grew from, you know, the little girl picture with sunglasses on in the corner to launching the jewelry line to launching the blog and just continuing to be a part of my industry. And you know, for Baxter, I don't think that he saw himself working in the fashion industry ever. He was a surfer dude when we met. But he loves and is passionate about technology and about strategy. And so together we are a great team, and we absolutely love what we do. And finally, focus on making other people successful. You know, it's easy to think about your own success and how can you personally be successful, but it's harder to think about making the people around you successful. But that's what Reward Style does every day. We're here to make other people economically successful, and that's why they're using our platform and why, you know, consumers are loving what we're doing and making purchases. So if you can focus on making other people successful, I can almost promise you that you will yourself be successful. I want to now move into QA so that we can talk about some of your questions and what's happening in your business. And thank you all for coming. I'm hoping we can get a good dialogue going. If you have any questions, we can come to the center aisle and we'll start QA.
Hi.
Yes.
Sorry, I'm a little short. Thank you for that. That was super helpful. I would love it if you could expand a little bit more on how your team was able to react so quickly to build Like to Know It, because that's always difficult, I find, with a changing industry like social.
Absolutely. You know, and there are so many platforms out there, and there's new ones popping up every single day, and there's ones that even got major investment, you know, dollars that seemed like they were going to be credible that really weren't. So what we looked at was, what are our clients doing? And so when we looked at how active they were on all of these channels, we made sure that the activity rate was high before we put investment. And so with Instagram, the numbers made sense, the data made sense, and they were really asking for something. And so at that point, we quite literally drove out to Marfa and sat there and said, we're not leaving until we have a plan. And we did it, you know, that weekend. So I think once you've seen that tipping point of like, our clients or our customers are here, this is where they want to be, this is gonna stay. I think at that point, that's when you invest.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. Hi. My question is about how you managed to get so many people on board knowing your product and using your product. Mm-hmm. I'd imagine that initially it might have been a hard slog, and I'm curious as to even now how much manual outreach there is to get people on board.
Right. So when we started Reward Style, we you know, were reaching out one by one, but then it became word of mouth very, very quickly. So I would say in any business, referrals will be quite important. We started working with some of the top publishers from day one just because of, you know, the smaller network that I had of those publishers, and then they referred their friends. Certainly our team is quite large now when you look at, you know, just managing those accounts plus growing those accounts. So we do see, you know, have a great, I don't know what industry you're in, but certainly have great, you know, forms. So when people are looking to work with you, they can, you know, apply easily and get there. But also think about incentivizing your current clients that are happy with your business to refer their friends.
Thank you. Yeah.
Hi, first of all, from Dallas. So great to hear other people, businesses coming from Dallas. But what, in terms of analytics, you talked about the purpose and the mission is to provide global partnerships. And so in what ways is Reward Style providing kind of analytics behind what partnerships are working, and how do you see that being important as Reward Style moves forward?
Yeah. Well, I would actually, I think when you're looking at what partnerships are working currently, last summer we took our first round of funding, so we had a Series A. And we brought a few angel investors on board, as well as a lead investor, Maverick Capital, a large hedge fund. And we had very specific ideas when we thought about what do we currently need and who can help us. When you're growing internationally, getting the attention of global retailers was hard. You know, it was hard when we started in the US and we had great success here, but in Sweden, they didn't know what we were doing, and in Russia, no one had heard of reward style. And so we thought, okay, well, who can we partner with that it's going to open doors for us locally in the regions that we're looking to expand to so that we can move quickly? Because we have the playbook now. It's got to be modified for each region, and we know who we're after. And so we looked specifically for partners like Maverick, who have international reach among retailers, even some of our angels who are here in the audience today, that had great relationships in the industry with brands on the ground in growth markets for us. And we partnered with them in a strategic and financial way.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Hi, can you share what the average commission is that these retailers are paying? And a success story of a blogger and how much they're able to earn using reward style?
So I think both of those are really great questions, and they're questions that our competitors would love to know. And because I know that many of them are here in the audience today, I'm not going to share any of that with you, but thank you.
Okay. this was close, but more technical. What formula do you use to track sales? Because you don't know on their website the actual final transaction, if it actually went through or not. How do you measure that?
Yes, so there's a lot of technology that exists that you can use to apply those models. So a technology that we use for tracking sales is called affiliate. And basically, affiliate technology has existed long, far and before reward style, most commonly applied in the coupon space. And so there are providers who do that really all around the world that will track those sales for you.
Okay, so it's kind of like an estimate, not a real?
No, it's real.
It's real.
So we're looking at exact cart prices, all of that very exact information.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi, how's it going?
Hi.
With social media having, very few barriers to entry, are you finding that it's becoming a crowded marketplace and there's very little opportunity for new bloggers in the space, or are they evolving and becoming successful?
We look very closely at that. So the question was about, kind of the evolving publisher and is there room for anybody else? While this graph doesn't specifically pertain to that, what I showed you earlier about, e-commerce just being still such a small piece of what's happening in the overall retail space, and it's such early days, it is still hugely early days in the blogging space. And what we actually see is that, when we started reward style 2011, I mentioned the newspaper article in 2010 about meet the blogger. Those publishers have now evolved their businesses and grown their business in different ways. There wasn't a playbook for them, so it took a little bit longer for them to get there. Now, when we look at the different reward style classes, meaning who started with us in what year, the classes of publishers who have started in more recent years actually see more hyper growth than those publishers that started quite a while back. And that's because the roadmap has really kind of been laid for what are those objective things that you can look at to see, are you going to be a successful publisher? So there's still a whole lot of opportunity across so many different channels and in so many different niches. And I would just say now let's just apply that playbook that's already been kind of laid out.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
I work for McDonald's and I was going to ask you about blogging in food, but I actually would love to know where your sandals are from.
I appreciate that. You can use like to know it to find out. No, actually they're old Zara, but I found a similar pair since they're a few seasons old that are similar and the same price point that you can buy if you use like to know it. Thank you. And actually, I just thought about something for the earlier question too. With this distribution that these social platforms are allowing, you no longer have to be in major business centers. You don't have to be in New York or LA in order to be a successful publisher. One of our most successful publishers is in a small town in the middle of America in a town that has less than 200,000 people, and she's one of the most successful publishers worldwide. And so there's certainly still an incredible amount of opportunity.
Hi, so this was great. Two-part question. How old is your youngest blogger? My daughter definitely wants to know.
Okay.
And then do your bloggers get basically screwed if the readers end up purchasing inside a brick-and-mortar store, or does your affiliate technology allow for some sort of tracking?
So starting with the bricks-and-mortar question, certainly we expect that, I hate to call it kind of attrition, but that slow drip into the retail stores. And it's been proven that I think it's about 45% of purchases that happen don't quote me, this was a college research paper, which was a long time ago, but a high percentage of people who buy in-store research online. Because of that, and because of the prevalence of that in certain sectors, even especially with beauty, are those retailers really adjust their commission rates to make sure that they remain attractive, because they're expecting to see that, you know, some of it's going to happen in a place that can't be tracked, and so we want to make sure that it's impactful and the publisher is rewarded whenever the transaction does occur online. And as far as the age of our influencers, you know, I know we have some in the teens, but I don't know who's actually the very youngest.
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yep. Hey there. Right. So the Like to Know It integration on Instagram, mm-hmm. to me, is ingenious. And I was just wondering if your team came up with that idea or if you saw it being used somewhere else and just incorporated it into your platform.
No, I can say with 100% certainty that Baxter and I came up with Like to Know It sitting in the Paisano in Marfa, Texas. It was something that we absolutely created, came back into the Reward Style office excited about this idea, literally drew it out how it would work on a table with a marker for our engineers, and we said, and if you build it in a month, we'll give you a bonus. So it was like, this is too good to miss. It makes so much sense. People are slaves to their inbox. It's your to-do list. This is where they'll want that information. And 1,000% a Reward Style developed and created an executed tool.
Very impressive.
Oh, thank you.
Another two-part question. The first one is, there's the generic term of bloggers, mm-hmm. But then would you say that Instagram has become the primary channel rather than blogs per se? And secondary on that point, do you see, how do you reconcile the tension between audience and engagement? Mm-hmm. As I have an influencer business mm-hmm. in Australia, and what I see is that quite often is with the larger the audience that gets, the lower the engagement. And in this kind of atomized environment where essentially it's the attention economy, do you see engagement as being just as important as reach?
Even more important, I would say. So the question was about, is engagement more important or equally as important as reach? And it's much more important. So for us, the objective measure of influence is retail sales. And you know, your customers are voting with their wallet. There might be 3 million people following you, but if only, you know, 5 people are actually making a purchase based on your recommendations, then for us, that's your influence, and that's how you are then compensated, is for those sales. So when we look at, you know, we work with people who have 16 million followers on Instagram and more. And then we work with someone who has 30,000 followers on Instagram who made, you know, close to, about $150,000 in 1 month last year. And so it's incredible to see that this publisher that I'm talking about with the smaller audience, they are hyper engaged. They, I mean, absolutely bow at her feet everything that she says, and she's really figured out how to tune into them and what kind of price points they want, how much content they want, and how to reach and engage with them. So certainly, you know, for our retailers, I think at the end of the day, we're all looking for a return on investment. Yeah. And so unless branding is the exercise, a lot of people, you know, are more interested in just, you know, dollars coming into the store, and, yeah. and so engagement is the most important. Remind me the first part of your question.
Well, I forget the first part. Okay. If I could follow up with a cheeky follow-up. In terms of that, a lot of clients are obsessed with reach. Mm-hmm. How do you address that actually it is engagement, that attention metric that is the most important? How do you get that across to them?
So I'm not sure if I totally understand the question, but I will say that we have retailers who are interested in branding exercises. There's certain retailers that it doesn't make sense. You know, there was a nice woman here from McDonald's earlier, and for us, you know, we can't track French fry purchases online. And so for them, you know, doing a campaign that's, you know, integrated into beautiful native content, that's going to be more of a reach campaign, but we can also target publishers based on, you know, their known conversion. But in that case, we're not going to be able to actually measure offline sales. Yeah. Does that help to?
Yeah, no, that's fine.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Amber, how are you?
Hi.
Thank you so much for the presentation today. It was very interesting and great to hear. My question is, you know, in the beginning of your presentation, you kind of went through some of the brands that you have either on board now or you've been working with, and you talked about the mid to larger kind of luxury brands. How do you and your company kind of recommend where the publisher, who they should partner with or what mm-hmm. they should kind of push for their clients, or do you guys kind of more reactively let them tell you what their readers are interested in?
So our goal is to have coverage across every retailer that would be interesting for our publishers to talk about. So we want to have Etsy before they think about, I need to link to Etsy today. And so we've forged 4,000 global brand partnerships to make sure that we can track and bill across all of these retailers, and then again, of course, across all of these 80 countries that our publishers live in and beyond. So for them, it's more that we make it available. And then on the retailer side, we're working with the retailers and the brands to find ways to make themselves attractive to the publishers, because the publisher has complete autonomy to link to or talk about whoever they like. You can think of us almost like a Google Analytics. So where Google is tracking every, sort of anything that's happening on the site from a visitor perspective, an interest perspective, we're actually, the analytics that's covering their site on any sort of brand or product level interest. And so we're giving them that feedback and helping them to curate their content so that's better and more targeted for their reader. So they know that no one liked when I linked to shoes the other day. Shoes don't do well on my site, but beauty does incredibly well. And here's, of the beauty retailers, here's the one that actually converts best for me. We're feeding all that information back to them so that they're more valuable to their own consumer and they get to know them better.
Thank you.
Hi, I really enjoyed your presentation. I was wondering, do you do any other sort of native help assist your publishers create those brand partnerships that go beyond the affiliate relationships, sponsored yes. content stories or product placement?
Yes, we do.
Okay, so.
Yeah, tell you a little bit about that. So, we started in what's called CPA, so cost per action, and that's where we're billing on the, on sales. The action there is sales. The second layer would just be, the flat rate campaigns and collaborations, and that can be anything from brokering content for Instagram ads to, brokering content that lives across the publisher's site. So it can be distributed across publisher, across content, across retailer content. It could be, even an in-store launch. So brokering really anything that's happening across our publisher network. And then we are actually currently in beta for reward style media, which is our CPM property, which is where our retailers are now being able to pay to place their ads on strategic publisher sites. And so that's kind of, I guess, a multi-layer approach to content marketing.
Great, thank you.
Hi, so I had a question. You talked about data-driven investment, and for a young brand, influencers are a little bit costly to partner up with. How would you judge, for a brand that has low revenue and low profit at the moment, how do you judge partnering up with an influencer and whether it's worth it?
Yes. Well, I think a couple of different things. First of all, it can be costly to do flat rate campaigns, and you're not guaranteed any sort of return. If you're able to run a campaign through reward style, we cast for your flat rate campaigns based on historical performance. So we want to see, let's say that you've got, a handbag line that's around, it's leather, it's around $100, it sells in the US. We're going to actually look at publishers who has the highest conversion rate in that product category at that price point in the regions you're looking to serve. And we can't guarantee a conversion, but we can certainly help, predict and what we think has happened and what has happened historically based on that type of content. So, we are the only ones with retailer, data, performance level data there. And so I would encourage you to use us for that. Mm-hmm. And then let's see, does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm a little short. Hi, my name is Anna Lee. I started a blog about a year ago almost. So I guess what advice do you give to bloggers and digital influencers who are up and coming to break through that, initial glass ceiling? Yeah, that's my
question. Yes. A couple of things. Consistency in your content. So choose your channels wisely based on what you believe you can conquer and what you have the bandwidth to publish to. Imagery is important, but you don't have to be so out of reach with your imagery. So you'll notice even on my own Instagram, they're all taken from a cell phone. I've invested in the imagery in that it all has the same filter, it fits together like a quilt really nicely, but they're all taken on a phone. So you don't need expensive equipment, you just need to know kind of what your brand vision is for your content. So publishing consistently, keep your images really beautiful. Plug into to publisher networks or local events, and the more people you meet, the more you're able to really kind of learn and glean. And you can pretty much learn anything online now. From signing up to a Skillshare to going to a local blogger meetup, learn from your peers. Like I mentioned earlier, there really is a roadmap now. So you look at the top performing publishers in the world and really dissect their sites and their content and see what they're doing right. And try and learn as much as you can about your own consumer, because that person is going to be different from mine than the top bloggers in the world, from Kendall Jenner's. It's going to be your own specific audience, and they're going to have a price point they like and a cadence they like and the image style. And so really, use what you can. There's a platform, even for Instagram, for example, that I've used in the past called Iconosquare, that gives me a lot of feedback about what my followers like there. A girl in Dubai actually told me she likes something called Social Blade. I've not used it, but she swears by it. So there's a lot of tools that you can use on an analytic perspective. Of course, use your Google Analytics, and if you're accepted to reward style, certainly comb through those. And we have tons of content that we create every day that's educational, that you could really make a full-time job out of reading. So just, yeah.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Hi. Hi. Appreciated what you have to say. I actually have a really good friend who had a relaunch of her blog party last night, or of her blog last night. In a world where there's traditional publishing, first I just want to ask, when you're saying publishers, are you referring to the bloggers that are working within the Like to Know It network?
So publishers for us and like our client reach is across bloggers, traditional magazines, it's Instagrammers, YouTubers, now celebrities, actresses, they all are using reward style because they have digital distribution. So we use publisher broadly for anybody who's publishing style-centric content digitally.
Okay, and just one more question.
Yeah.
In terms of this whole movement of more and more bloggers coming through, how do you think that you're portraying kind of a realistic outlook for somebody who is a teenager to late teens to early 20s that says to themselves, I really want to make a career, but they still actually have to put food on the table? What kind of, I would say, outreach do you put back out there to help train these girls or guys when they want to make a career out of it?
Right now we focus on the clients that we're able to accept into the reward style community. And so that's who we're really investing heavily in. Certainly, I and our team do speaking engagements all in different communities. None of our content is something digitally that we're putting online. But I think if you read anything, even especially about my story, you saw that, I think when we opened the reward style office, something I didn't mention was that I was living at home, eating cereal and had less than $300 in my bank account. I had a jewelry line, I had a personal shopping business. I was trying to launch this other thing. And so it's, you don't start blogging and then tomorrow turn into Oprah. It's something to where, you might need to be doing other things to make ends meet until it does happen. And for some people, it happens in an extraordinary way. And for other people, it's a great supplement to their primary income.
Cool. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Hello. So I'm a publisher, and I know that it's pretty competitive to be affiliated with Reward Style. But I'm just curious for retailers what you're looking for, because I also know that it's pretty competitive for retailers as well.
Yes. I don't know if you've ever applied to Reward Style as a retailer. I think some of the things listed on our form are just even, we're looking at the number of SKUs. So how many products do you actually have that you're offering? Your depth of inventory? How long have you been a retailer? Is there a great opportunity for you as a retailer when you're working with us? And is there a great opportunity for our publishers? And if we do drive our consumers to your site, are they going to have a good experience? So we want to make sure that everything's really aligning before we would invest in that partnership. But certainly, breadth and depth of product, and really kind of the quality of the e-commerce retailer, if there's someone that's relevant to our publisher base and that they would want to be linking to.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Is that all the questions? Okay.
It's not a question, it's just a complaint. Because of your influencers, I have to run to Sephora because my wife sent me a list with $1,600 worth of products.
And on that, we'll close. Thank you all so much for coming here tonight. I really appreciate your attention.